We are extremely proud. It's a very, very joyous paper, the Ramanujan Memorial Lecture 2018. Shaha Institute of Nuclear Physics hosts a few of these kinds of memorial lectures. They are Meghnad Shaha Memorial Lecture, J.C. Bose Memorial Lecture, and Ramanujan Memorial Lecture. Professor Ashok Sen delivered Meghnad Shaha Memorial Lecture in 1998. I remember that lecture very well. That was not in this auditorium. This auditorium was not built then, in 1998, on what is string theory. And previous Ramanujan lectures include scientists such as Professor Michael Berry, Professor Anthony Leggett, and few other such names. I now call our director, Professor Ajit Kumar Mohanty, to come and introduce Professor Ashok Sen.
Good afternoon to all of you, Professor Sen, distinguished speakers of the day, colleagues, invitees, students, our friends from the media, ladies and gentlemen. Professor Ashok Sen, who will be delivering Ramanujan Memorial Lecture, doesn't require any introduction to this crowd. At least it is clear from the overwhelming response in the crowds and attendance, because we have less chair than the people. But however, it is a customary to introduce the speaker, which I will be doing with pleasure. Professor Ashok Sen is a distinguished professor at the Harishchandra Research Institute, Allahabad, and works in the area of string theory. He earned his Bachelor of Science degree in 1975 from Presidency College and completed his master's from IIT Kanpur. He completed his doctoral work in physics from the State University of New York and Stony Brook in 1982, from Fermilab, USA, and Stanford Linear Accelerator, USA. Subsequently, he came back to India and joined the Tata Institute of Fundamental Research in 1988, where he remained till 1995. Finally, he moved to Harishchandra Research Institute in 1995. Now, Professor Sen is a distinguished faculty at Harishchandra Research Institute. Professor Sen has made a number of major original contributions to the subject of string theory, including his landmark work on strong weak coupling duality, or S-duality, study of unstable deep brains, Sen conjecture about open string tachyon condensation, entropy function formalism for statistical interpretation of Bekenstein-Hawking entropy of black holes. He has won numerous prestigious awards. To name a few, Professor Sen is a recipient of Dirac Medal, Fundamental Physics Prize, Infosys Prize, G.D. Birla Award for Scientific Research, TWS Prize, Bhatnagar Prize, ICTP Prize, and finally, the Government of India has conferred Padma Shri and Padma Bhushan to Professor Sen. He is also a Fellow of Royal Society of UK. With this brief introduction, now I invite Professor Sen to give the Ramanujan Memorial Lecture on the Future of Our Universe. Professor Sen.
This Ramanujan Memorial Lecture here. Today, future is a very long-term future of the universe and what the fundamental physics tells us about the future. The other one is high Z supernova search. Both of them simultaneously, or more or less simultaneously, made a profound discovery. What they found was that 70% of the energy density in our universe. Now, dark energy has more or less become a household word. So, perhaps many of you have heard of dark energy in some form or the other. However, what is not widely appreciated is how its discovery has drastically changed our perspective on the future of our universe. And today's talk will be the story of this future. What does the discovery of dark energy say say about the future. So this the first part, I'll describe the classical story. This will be somewhat brief. Then I'll describe the quantum story. And finally, I'll try to combine the two and see what we can learn about the future of our universe. So the classical story begins with a very old observation. We have known for a long time that the universe has been expanding. And when I say that the universe has been expanding, this means that every two objects which are far away move away from each other. And further the objects are from each other, the faster they move apart away from each other. So this is what is called the expansion of the universe. But the presence of dark energy adds to this expansion by saying that the expansion rate is actually increasing with time. In other words, our universe is not only undergoing an expansion, but it's undergoing an accelerated expansion. Now, this is a consequence of Einstein's general theory of relativity, that in the presence of dark energy, the universe undergoes accelerated expansion. And in fact, the way dark energy was discovered is by reversing this argument. People first discovered that our universe is undergoing an accelerated expansion from observations of supernova. And from there, they reconstructed the fact that the universe is filled with dark energy. So more precisely, according to our current understanding, the size of the universe will double in about every 12 billion years. Okay, that's 1.2 times 10 to the 10. And one can make it quantitative by saying that even if we travel today at the speed of light, we can reach points in our universe which are at most at a distance of 16 billion light years from us today. On the other hand, we can see the universe, the objects in the universe, up to 45 billion light years. So many of the objects that we can see today, we can never reach. And this is because of the fast rate that they are moving away from each other. However fast we move, okay, and limited by the speed of light, we can never reach those far away places. So technically we say that these points, these regions of the universe, which you can see but not reach, they are outside our horizon. And one can extrapolate it and conclude that in the far future, our local group of galaxies will be the only ones that will be within our horizon. Now, if we look into the sky with a telescope, we see many galaxies. Some are close to us, which are called the local group. Some are far away. Today, we can reach them if we try hard enough. But in the far future, we can never reach them. So all the other galaxies, other than the local group, which are the reason that the local group will be together is because of the gravitational force that binds them together. Okay, that here, the gravitational force is sufficiently strong, so the local group of galaxies will be bound together even in the far future. But anything outside this local group will move away so fast from us that we can never reach them. So in particular, we can imagine that before that time, before this very far future, we may manage to populate some of these nearby galaxies, okay, not nearby galaxies, but nearby enough, but beyond this local group. It is certainly physically possible. No laws of physics prevents us from populating some of these galaxies. But in the far future, we'll lose complete contact with any of them. Okay, it will be theoretically impossible for us to communicate with these distant galaxies, okay, even if we manage to send humans to these galaxies today. Now, here is a graph that illustrates this phenomenon. It's somewhat technical. Okay? If you don't understand all the details, it doesn't really matter because it basically captures whatever I have told you so far in a graphical form. So in this graph, what we have plotted, the vertical direction is time. Okay? But I have used a somewhat unusual coordinate. I have not plotted time, but I have plotted this combination. K is a constant. More precisely, it's about 1.7 times 10 to the 10 years, or 17 billion years. So what I have plotted in the vertical direction is this combination minus k e to the minus t over k. So you can see that as t goes to infinity, this goes to zero. So that's the end of time. So even though in the usual time, it's actually infinite future, in this capital T coordinates, time ends here. This is today, t equal to zero, where capital T is minus k, as you can see from here. In the horizontal direction, I have plotted the distance away from us. So this line describes us. We are moving vertically in time without changing our position. This is another galaxy which is away from us. What it shows, what is shown in the horizontal direction is not quite the distance, but the distance times this particular function of time. Here k is the same constant, 17 million years, and c is the velocity of light. Now, in this graph, the galaxies all move vertically upwards. Okay? They are stationary, they move vertically upwards. Now, from this picture, it seems as if their distance remains the same, but that's of course not quite true, because what you see is the separation of this variable remains the same, but the actual distance is increasing because it gets multiplied by the inverse of this time. So even though in this plot, it looks like the separation between A and B remain constant, actually the physical separation is increasing as a function of time. And that's what captures the expansion of the universe. Another feature, the reason that I have chosen these variables for this graph is the following, that in this graph, one can show that the light always travels at 45 degree angle to the body. Okay, so these are the light rays. And all the massive objects whose speed must be less than that of light, they move along some trajectory which makes an angle, whose tangent makes an angle that is less than 45 degrees of the vertical. So this is a possible trajectory. This makes only zero angle of the vertical, or we can have trajectory going like this. So now, let's suppose that at this point in the future, we send out some light signal. They will travel at 45 degrees. And we can clearly see that those light signals can actually reach these other galaxies, because the path of the light signal intersects the path of this. In fact, we can even send human beings in a rocket. Okay, they'll not quite travel at the speed of light, but maybe say at an angle that is slightly less than 45 degrees of the particle, they can still reach these other galaxies. So today, we can actually access these galaxies either by light or even by normal space. But as we progress in time, at this point in time, we can see that now if we send out light rays, however hard we try, we can never reach this galaxy. And this is what one means by saying that at this point in time, the B has gone out of the horizon of A, because it's impossible for A to communicate with B. Even light signal cannot reach B. Of course, spaceships which are contained within this 45 degree angle, they can never reach B. So this is the graphical way to demonstrate what I described in the earlier slides qualitatively. This is a quantitative way of explaining why is it true that while we can reach these other galaxies today or in the near future, if we wait for sufficiently long time, we can never reach these other galaxies. We lose all communication with these other galaxies. Okay, so this is as much as I'll say about the classical story. Let me now turn to the quantum story. How does quantum mechanics change this picture? So this story begins with that of a particle sliding on a hill. Okay, so let's forget about the universe for now and just consider a particle that is sliding on a hill. And I have considered a hill which has two values, okay, A and B. And we know from our everyday experience, also from the classical Newton's laws, that if there is friction, then the particle will go back and forth in this valley, and eventually it will come to rest at a valley. Okay, after it loses its energy by kinetic energy by friction, it will come to rest at a valley, and it can come to rest either at A or at B. Now let's suppose that it comes to rest at A, And then everyday experience tells us that it will continue to rest at A forever unless we disturb it. So this is what happens classically. But quantum mechanics tells us that there is always some internal disturbance to the particle. The particle never sits at rest. And indeed, according to quantum mechanics, there is a tiny probability, very tiny, but nevertheless a non-zero probability, that suddenly the particle which was sitting at A may appear here, and once it appears here, then it can start rolling down and eventually settle in B. So while classically a particle sitting at A will sit there forever, quantum mechanically it can tunnel and reach this point B, which is a more stable one. Now this of course is just a toy example. Our interest is not in a particle, but in the whole universe. But the reason that I describe this particle picture is because our universe in many sense behaves like a particle rolling on a hill. So the dynamics of the universe is described by what we call a field theory, not a particle theory. So what is a field? You can think of a field as if it's like a particle at every point in space, which are moving in some unseen direction. So as if you put a particle at every point in space, and the particles are moving independently in some unseen directions, not in one of these three directions. Those are called the field directions. And we can also imagine that neighboring particles are somehow tied by springs, so that if we try to move the neighboring particles relative to each other, it costs some energy. While it may be easy to move two particles together, but if we want to displace one relative to the other, it will cost some energy, as if they are tied by some spring. So a familiar example of this, of a field theory, or of a field, is the electric field. The electric field, as you know, is described by three components, which we call Ex, Ey, and Ez, the X component, Y component, and Z component of the electric field. So at every point in P, every point P in space, Ex, Ey, and Ez take certain value. And these you can think of like the, as if they are the coordinate of a particle P in this three unseen directions. So of course, you have the usual space, but you can think of the value of the electric field at a given point in space as if it's the coordinate of a particle in some other three unseen directions. The field theory that we will be interested in is in fact simpler than the theory of electric field. So the simplest possible field is what is called a scalar field. So what is the difference between a scalar field and an electric field? The difference is that unlike electric field, which has three components, so to specify an electric field, you have to specify Ex, Ey, and Ez at every point in space. To specify a scalar field, we have to specify only one component, which we can call A. So you specify just one component at every point in space, and that describes a scalar field. So this is like a particle at every point in space, which moves in some one unseen direction. And just like the motion of a particle is controlled by a potential, the motion of a scalar field is also controlled by a potential, which plays the role of the height of the hill that you saw earlier. So let's go back to our earlier picture, a hill with two valleys. So in the same vein, let's consider a potential with two minimum at A and B. It's like a hill with two valleys. And if a scalar field has such a potential, then again it can rest at either minimum. Either the field can take its value at A everywhere in space, or it can take its value at B everywhere in space. So these are two stable configurations. The field sitting at A or the field sitting at B. So it's like the particle at every point in space can be either sitting at the point A, or the particle at every point in space can sit at the point B. So these are these two states of the universe, or of the field, are called two phases of the scalar field. And this height V now represents potential energy per unit volume. Okay, because in the when you are talking about the universe, of course the total energy is infinite, but you talk about energy per unit volume, and that's what is represented by this potential. And from this perspective, what we call dark energy is basically the height of the potential at the minimum. Okay, so this height here is the value of the dark energy for the phase A, and this height here is the value of the dark energy for the phase B. So you see that in this picture, A has positive dark energy, and B has negative dark energy. And we know theoretically both are possible. Well, experimentally, we know that the dark energy that we have is positive. Now, when we have such a system, such a situation, that you have a potential with two different phases, two different minima, and hence two possible phases, the properties of these two phases are typically very, very different. Even the properties of the elementary particles, like the mass and the charge of the electron, are different in these different phases. In fact, it may happen that the electron exists in this phase, but not in the other phase. We really have not much control of the relationship between the theory in one phase, or the particle spectrum, their masses, charges, etc. in one phase, and the particle spectrum, masses and charges in the other phase. So this I have already said, dark energy is the value of the potential at the local minimum. So you can see that these different phases also will have different dark energy. This has positive dark energy, this has negative. So now, let's go back to quantum mechanics. And let's recall the case of a particle on a hill. So if there is a particle rolling on a hill, then it could sit either at A or at B. And if the particle was sitting at A, then the classical laws will tell us that it will sit there forever. But quantum mechanics tells us that there is a small probability that it can appear here and then roll down. Okay, this is what we had for case of particle rolling on a hill. What you want to do is to study whether a similar phenomenon is possible for the field. If the field was sitting at A, is it possible that it will roll down to the field sitting at B? Can a similar tunneling happen in a quantum field theory? Now you see that in quantum theory of fields, the situation is somewhat different. Because here what we have, phase A describes not a single particle sitting at A, but it's like infinitely many particles sitting at A, because the particle at every point in space are sitting at the minimum A. If it has to make a transition to the phase B, then the particle sitting at every point in space has to jump to phase B. And one can calculate the probability of this happening, and one can show that the probability is actually zero. It's zero because the probability that one particle tunnels from A to B is small but finite. But you multiply it infinite number of times, and a number which is small, if you multiply it infinite number of times, it goes to zero. So it's the probability that the universe at one single go will jump from phase A to phase B is zero. However, something else can happen here. What may happen is that while the field doesn't tunnel from A to B everywhere in space, there may be a small region of space where the field make a transition from A to B. This probability one can calculate and show that this is actually a finite probability, that in a small region, the field can jump from A to B. And in fact, the smaller the region, the higher the probability, because less number of particles would have to jump from A to B. So we learn that quantum mechanics tells us that there is a finite probability of producing bubbles of B inside the phase A, and smaller bubbles are more probable. Now, if quantum mechanics produce such a bubble, one can ask what will be its fate. It certainly produces small bubbles of this kind copious, okay, because that probability is not very small. So if this happens, we can see that there are two competing effects. One is that the bubble, if the bubble expands, the potential energy is lowered, because inside the potential energy is lower than outside, the potential energy density. So the more region is in the phase B, the lower is the potential energy. And we know from experience that any system always tries to lower its potential energy. If you drop a ball, it falls on the ground because it tries to lower its potential energy. On the other hand, we can see that there is a surface energy, because as at the interface, on one side of the interface, the particle is in B, or the field is in B. On the other side of the interface, the field is in A. And I told you earlier that it's like the neighboring particles are connected by spring. So if there is relative displacement, it costs energy. So as the bubble grows, the surface tension effect, the surface energy, there is surface energy associated with the surface of the bubble, that increases. So that's a positive contribution. So there is a competition as to whether the net potential energy is actually lowered or raised by expanding the bubble. And it, a little thought shows that while if the bubble is very small, then if it tries to expand a little, okay, actually the potential energy grows. So there the classical tendency will be to shrink back the bubble to zero size. It, surface tension basically pulls it back. But if a sufficiently large bubble is produced, then that barrier is broken, and then you find that now growing the bubble actually lowers the potential energy. It lowers the potential energy because of potential energy density is negative here, is less here compared to this. And that overcomes the fact that the expansion of the bubble will increase the surface energy. So once a sufficiently large bubble is produced, the bubble begins expanding, and in that process, lowers its potential energy. Now, of course, total energy is conserved, so the potential energy essentially goes into the surface energy, into the kinetic energy of the wall of the bubble, or the surface of the bubble, and it starts accelerating. Okay, so this bubble starts growing, and the speed at which it's growing starts becoming larger and larger till it reaches the speed of light. So soon the speed of expansion of the surface approaches the speed of light. And eventually, if it keeps expanding, it converts A to B everywhere. And so for this reason, often A is known as a false vacuum. If we are living in a vacuum, in a phase like A, we'll be living there happily, okay, thinking that we are in a nice stable vacuum because nothing is happening to the vacuum. But suddenly, if a small bubble of B is produced, okay, which can grow, it will completely wipe out everything that is in A, okay, and convert A to B everywhere. So given this, one can ask, what will be the fate of any living or non-living object in A during this process? And the answer to this, in fact, is very simple. There will be total instantaneous destruction of everything that lives in A. And the reason is simple, because, as I said, even the elementary particles in A are not there in B. The elementary particles of B have very different properties, different masses, different charges, different properties. So for example, a proton doesn't even exist in B. So once this phase transition takes place, once A gets converted to B, anything that existed in A will be totally wiped out, except some fluctuations in energy density that will be now encoded in some of the other degrees of freedom of B. So for this reason, from the point of view of A, we can call this the killer bubble, okay, because it kills everything on the way, the whole universe. So given that there is such a possibility, we can then ask, are we living in a false vacuum? Is the phase of the universe in which you are living like A, or is it like B? Now, the possibility that we may be living in a false vacuum, in fact, is not new. It has been known for about 50 years. People have thought about this, and it's very much possible that our vacuum is like A. But there are some recent developments which have generated renewed interest in this subject, both in some sense experimental but also partly theoretical. I'll explain. So one reason that people got interested in this again is an experiment in 2012. Okay, this is an experiment at CERN, and you probably have all heard that in this experiment, CERN discovered the first example of a scalar field in nature, and that's called the Higgs field, or the Higgs part. Now, we do not yet have sufficient knowledge about the potential of this field, but some preliminary calculations indicate that we may actually be in a false vacuum of the Higgs field. The potential of the Higgs field may be of the kind that I described. It has a potential that describes us, but there will be another potential. It has a minimum that describes us, but there will be another minimum somewhere else, okay, which has lower value of the energy density, and that describes, in a sense, the true vacuum. There at least a vacuum that is more stable than us. If that is the case, then it is probable that someday we may tunnel to this other vacuum by the process that I described, formation of bubble and subsequent expansion. This is not confirmed yet. This depends on some particular measurement, which is called the top quark mass, and the measurement is not accurate enough to distinguish between whether you are actually in a true vacuum or the false vacuum, whether the other minimum exists, and if it exists, whether it's above us or below us. But in our current understanding of the data, it could be either way. But the actual situation is, in fact, much worse, because there are various theoretical reasons to believe that there are many more scalar fields in our theory than what we have observed so far. Higgs field is the only field we have observed so far, only scalar field. But there are many other scalar fields that possibly exist in the full theory. And we do not know if among these other unknown fields, there are scalars whose false vacuum describes us. You see, if you have more scalars, then instead of having a potential which is one dimension, with a potential that I have plotted where there is only one Higgs field, it's a multidimensional field. And you can think of this as a landscape in this multidimensional field space with many ups and downs, many valleys. We may be living in one of the valleys. And the question will be whether there are other valleys around us which has lower energy density so that we can tunnel to this energy, to this lower energy density factor. So the only way we can possibly hope to know this for sure is some sort of fundamental theory in which a list of fields are fixed from some fundamental principle. If we had an understanding of the basic laws of nature, okay, the fundamental theory, then the fundamental theory will tell us what the shape of the potential is, what are the fields that are there in the theory, and then we could in principle calculate the value of the potential at each minimum, compare it the value of the potential at our minimum, and see if you are in the false vacuum or the true vacuum, whether you are in the stable phase or an unstable phase. Now, string theory is an attempt to have such a fundamental theory. This is a proposal for a theory that describes all the elementary particles and their forces. So today's talk is not really about string theory, so I'll not say very much about string theory. But the relevant part of string theory that I want to use is the following. That whatever we understand about string theory today, we know that string theory has many scalar fields with complicated potential, with many local maxima and minima. So here I have plotted in one dimension because it's easier, but of course the actual base of fields is multidimensional. There are multiple fields, multiple scalar fields. But the basic picture is that the potential has many ups and downs in this multidimensional space. And it has many minima, some below zero, some above zero, and so on. This is sometimes called the landscape of vacua in string theory. And if we focus on any particular minimum, we can in principle calculate all the properties of all the elementary particles in that minimum. We can calculate its decay probability to other lower minimum, and so on. So So if string theory is right, then one of these minima describes the phase of the theory that you are living. And indeed, we have found many phases whose elementary particles have properties similar to the ones we see in nature. But we do not yet know of a phase that describes exactly the elementary particles that we see. So in other words, even if string theory is the right description of nature, at present we do not know our position in the landscape. We may be here or we may be here, we don't know. But there are some things we know. And that's where we want to focus our attention. So, given that we don't know where we are, what can we say about whether it is a false vacuum or a true vacuum, assuming that the string theory is correct? So, two things we know are the following. First, we know the dark energy exists, and that the value of the dark energy is positive. That has been measured. So the discovery of dark energy tells us that in the phase you are living in, the potential is positive. So for example, in the previous picture, we know that we are not living here or here, or you may be living here or here. Potential energy is positive. On the other hand, from theoretical studies, we know that in string theory, there are many phases which have either zero or negative potential. So we know of existence of phases of this type. This has zero potential, this has negative potential. And this is sufficient to conclude that if string theory is the right description of nature, then we must be living in a false vacuum. Because the phase in which you are living, the vacuum, the phase and vacuum are synonymous in this language, the phase or the vacuum in which you are living, there you know that the potential energy density is positive. And you know that string theory has vacuum or phase where the potential energy density is zero or negative. So this means that we are not the lowest. And if you are not the lowest, there is always a small probability that someday a bubble of this fall of the true vacuum will be produced inside us, and that will then expand and destroy the current form of the universe. So given this conclusion, okay, assuming that string theory is right and we are truly living in a false vacuum, we can then ask the next question. What is the probability of our decaying into the true vacuum or another false vacuum of lower potential? So we don't have to decay into the true vacuum. If there is a bubble of lower potential energy density, that's sufficient, right? That may not have, need not be the lowest. So what is our half-life? Now what is half-life? This is the time during which the decay probability will reach half. But it's a somewhat unusual question, because normally you think of half-life of radioactive atoms, right? Here you are talking about the half-life of the whole universe. Okay, the probability that the whole universe will be destroyed in certain time period. Now, this we cannot answer today. If we knew our position in the landscape, then of course we could calculate this using the basic laws of string theory. But as I have already told you, we don't know our position in the landscape. We don't know what nearby minima are, how far they are, okay, and half-life will depend on all this information. So we cannot today calculate the half-life from fundamental principles. If someday we learn where we are in the landscape, then we could calculate. But in the absence of that knowledge, the best we can do is to rely on circumstantial evidence. So let's see, what do you know from experiment? What can you see about our half-life from experiment, from whatever you know in experiment? So one of the information that we have about our universe is that it's about 14 billion years old. Okay, that's about 1.4, or more precisely, 1.38 times 10 to the 10 years old. So given that our universe has lived for 14 billion years, leads to the conclusion that unless you have been extremely lucky, the half-life of the phase that you are living in must be larger than 14 billion years. Otherwise, our universe would have been destroyed already by now. The fact that our universe has not been destroyed suggests that our half-life cannot be smaller than 14 billion. Now, this may make you feel comfortable. Okay, 14 billion years is a long time. But I should remind you that a half-life of 14 billion years doesn't mean that you're going to live for the next 14 billion years. That's not the way the probability works. So the half-life of 14 billion years, okay, translates to the following statement, that the probability that during the next 1 year we'll be hit by one of these killer bubbles is less than about 1 in 10, 10 to the 10. Or more correctly, 1 in, say, 1.4 times 10. Okay, this is all we can say. But there is a possibility that this will happen tomorrow. The probability is small, but it's there. The fact that our half-life is larger than 14 billion years translates to the fact that the probability is smaller than 1 in 10 billion. We don't know how much. But we might try to get an estimate of how small in this number, is this number. 10 to the 10 is a large number. 1 in 10 to the 10 is a small probability. But how small is it? Is it imaginable? Okay, what is 1 in 10 to the 10? So this we can, in fact, understand in a physical example. So let's suppose that one day a small asteroid hits the Earth and destroys everything within 100 meter radius of the point of impact. So the chance that you will be within 100 meter radius of the impact point is about 1 in 10. This you can easily calculate from the radius of the Earth, that take any point on Earth at random, the fact that that point will be within 100 meter radius from where you are standing is about 1 in 10 to the 10. So that's how small this problem is. Now, it turns out the situation is actually a little worse, okay, not very much worse. And the reason that it's a little worse is because our chance of encountering a killer bubble is actually increasing with time. Because as time progresses, the bubbles produced farther and farther away from us can come and hit us. So, for example, our chance of encountering a killer bubble today is about 3.7 times higher than the average chance of encountering a killer bubble in the past. So, there is this factor of 3.7, which may not make that much difference in the estimate, but it's there. So, now I'm going to combine this classical story with the quantum story. That what can we learn now by combining these two stories, okay, the two aspects of the discovery of dark energy? One is the accelerated expansion of the universe, and the other one is the possibility that the universe that we're living in a false vacuum, okay, is in an unstable place. So the picture is here. So let's suppose that the white region is the region where this describes the phase A. And this white region is continuously expanding. Okay, that's a classical effect. It's undergoing an accelerated expansion. But as it undergoes an accelerated expansion, there are small probabilities, a small probability that bubbles will be formed here and there. These are the killer bubbles, which form here and there. And once they form, within a very short time, they start expanding at the speed of light. So the bubble walls start expanding at the speed of light. Now, there are two possibilities. You see, there are two competing effects. The bubbles are being produced and expanding. The other effect is the exponential expansion of the universe. The universe is undergoing an accelerated expansion. So the question is, which one wins? So the two possibilities are the following. The first possibility is that the expansion rate of the universe is larger than the rate at which killer bubbles are being produced. If this possibility is true, then there will be leftover white spaces. Because white space, this is the phase A. If the expansion rate of the universe is faster than the rate at which the bubbles are produced, then eventually there will be leftover white spaces where we can still live. That because at the end, the universe will be in the same phase that where we are in. However, if the expansion rate is slower than the rate at which the bubbles are produced, then the whole universe will be consumed by killer bubbles and there will be no space left for us. So the ultimate future of our universe depends on this particular competition. If the expansion rate is faster than the rate of production of the bubbles, then the universe will still have some spaces where normal electrons and protons can exist, and hence we can exist. If not, then there will be no region in the universe where we can exist, because normal electrons and protons do not exist. At present, we do not know which of this is true. We have a very good idea of what the expansion rate of the universe is, but we do not really have a good idea of what the probability of producing these bubbles are. All we have is a bound, but that doesn't help. Even with that bound, it can go either way. Now, let's suppose that we are lucky, that the expansion rate is larger than the decay rate. Then you may be happy, there will be still spaces left in the universe where we can live. If we are lazy, then it will not work. We can do a simple calculation and we can show that if we stay in one place, then eventually a killer bubble will destroy us, because there is always a probability that a killer bubble will be produced in our vicinity and it will hit us. So even in the best possible circumstances, the only way to survive will be to spread out to different regions of the universe which are still reachable. Because as I described at the beginning, over time, if we do this, then over time, the expansion of the universe will move these regions out of each other's horizon. And once that happens, then even if a killer bubble hits one of these regions, it cannot reach other regions. And some of our descendants will survive. So I'll try to illustrate this again by drawing the same kind of diagram that I described earlier. And hopefully that will make things a little clearer. So if you remember this diagram, time was being plotted in the vertical direction. Okay, it's not quite time, it's this combination. And the distance scaled by this combination was plotted in the horizontal direction. And we had said that in this picture, light travels at 45 degree angle of the vertical. All other objects travel at less than 45 degree angle of the vertical. This is our galaxy. We are moving along this line. And this is another galaxy, okay, which is moving along this line. Today, we can establish colony in this galaxy. So we can send out people, we can send out light signal, and we can also send out people to occupy this galaxy and colonize it. But eventually, we'll go out of each other's horizon. It will be impossible for us to send signal to this other galaxy. Now that, in the first sight, looks like a disappointing fact that we have established colonies, but we cannot communicate with them. But if you think about it, okay, you'll realize that it's actually a blessing. Because if we cannot send light signal, then that means that a killer bubble that is produced in our vicinity also cannot reach the other galaxy. Because the killer bubbles also expand at the speed of light. And that's what you see here. So let's imagine that we are living, we are coexisting, okay? We have gone out of each other's horizon. And then suddenly, some killer bubble is produced near our vicinity. It starts from a small size, but then of course it starts expanding. Its walls start expanding at the speed of light, so it spreads out like the way I have drawn here. Okay, so 45 degree angle here is the angle along with the light property. So this black region of space-time is the other phase of the universe. Okay? The phase where we cannot live. Okay, because electrons and protons don't exist here. But as should be clear from this diagram, that this destruction doesn't affect this image. In fact, they will not even be aware of the fact that you have been destroyed. Because no light signal from this region is ever going to reach there. So they will be safe. Now, of course, there is another probability that some other time, some other killer bubble will be produced in the vicinity of this universe, this galaxy, and it will destroy them. But if we keep multiplying with time, okay, if we increase the number of such colonies, then one can show, okay, that by keeping on multiplying at sufficiently fast rate, we can beat the killer bubbles and we can survive. In principle, forever. In practice, probably not more than, say 1,000 billion years, because by that time, the stars will die. Okay, so, I mean, even if the universe is not destroyed by phase transition, there will be no stars around which you can get, where you can get energy. So, one can do a quick calculation, and one can show that if we establish two settlements, that increases life expectancy by a factor of 3/2. So if with one settlement, that is one establishment like ours, if the life expectancy is, say, some certain value, then you have, if you have two such establishments, then it becomes 3.5 times the original value. And if you have n settlements, then the life expectancy increases by a factor which is given here. And if you know the series is divergent, so by making n sufficiently large, you can make this number as large as you want. So the life expectancy in principle can be sent to infinity by establishing large number of colonies. But as I said, in any case, we probably cannot live longer than the time over which the stars in the galaxies will all die natural death. And this can be estimated, and that's of the order of 10 to the 14 years. One can show that by that time, the universe will be so diluted because of this accelerated expansion that no new stars will form and all the existing stars will die. So as long as you can delay death by killer bubble beyond this day, we would have done the best we could. Now it's clear that even creating one additional settlement sufficiently far away is going to involve a lot of effort. But this is probably the only way to ensure long-term survival of our civilization. Thank you very much.
Chance that it can decay, you can have that thing right now, not it can have any time. Like radioactive.
Yeah.
Take a proton decay, 10 to about 34. You take 10 to about 34 proton, and maybe one proton can decay.
Yes. But as I described, already in our universe, there are many regions which cannot communicate with each other. That we can see today, regions of the universe, which are 45 billion light years away. But we can only reach distances up to 10 to the 10 light years. Okay? So this means that we already have, our universe has already gotten divided into disconnected regions. Okay? There are regions of the universe which are outside each other's horizon. If now one of those universes make phase transition, then that will affect only some part of the universe and not the other. And this means that already we know that there is the probability, it makes sense because you have not one universe, but you have many universes. Some of them will make this transition, some of them will not. That's the sense in which you talk about probability. That instead of thinking of many protons, right? And then you, if the probability makes sense, here you have many disconnected regions of the universe which cannot communicate with each other. Okay? And the probability refers to those disconnected regions, that is multiple copies of the universe. So that's the answer to your second question. The first question you are saying, yes, the point is, that's what I said, it doesn't happen at one go, right? The way the tunneling happens is that in a small region, this tunneling happens. The probability of having such tunneling in a small region is still small, but the smaller the region, the higher the probability. But if you make it too small, then such a region cannot expand because the surface tension will pull it back. So there is a balance, and you can calculate based on that balance that how much is the probability that it will tunnel to a sufficiently large size so that it can then start expanding, overcoming the surface tension. That is the probability which determines this decay probability, okay, the half-life.
We can take perhaps one more question.
Sir, thank you for your discourse.
If I have understood correctly, dark energy represents the existence of the potential in certain scalar fields, which can be at a lower level than the ones we are existing in.
Yes.
Right. So the current composition is about 70% in our universe of dark energy.
Yes.
So if these so-called killer bubbles are expanding with time and they exist in some place in this universe, is the percentage of dark energy increasing with time as well?
Yes, of course. The percentage of dark, that's a classical effect. That doesn't even need the killer bubble. Because as time increases, the dark energy component remains fixed. But the ordinary energy density, the dark matter energy density, that falls off rapidly as a function of time. So soon, the universe will be dominated by dark energy. Okay, the component of the dark matter will be very, very tiny. And as time progresses, the dark energy will basically be the only energy density that will remain.
Okay.
And so dark matter really doesn't affect this discussion that much. Okay, it's the dark energy difference that controls whether the tunneling will take place or not.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yeah, I now request our director.
Maybe I should just add also one more point that, I mean, it looks somewhat esoteric that one universe makes space transition to another universe. Okay? But this is very similar to what happens in a supercooled liquid. Okay, if you take a supercooled water and leave it undisturbed, it remains as water, okay, forever. Well, not forever, maybe, for a long time. But a small disturbance, okay, as a small ball of ice dropped in the water, will act as a nucleation center, and then that ice will start growing. Okay, and the whole water will become ice. So this transition from A to B, okay, is like transition from supercooled water to ice. Pardon? Well, constituents are different. The constituents are strings. Okay? The manifestation of those constituents in this different vacuum are different. Okay? So the underlying theory is not changing. Right? It's just like the phonons in ice do not exist in water. So what we think of the electrons and photons, right? The electrons and other elementary particles, they are like the phonons in solid state physics. And just as the ice has phonons, but water doesn't. There are water waves. It's the same. Okay? It's in that sense that the elementary particles don't exist in these other places. But the basic theory remains the same. Okay? That's the string theory. But that doesn't help. Okay? Because electrons and protons are what manifest. We are manifestations of some particular phase of the universe. Okay? Like where the electrons and protons are the excitons. Okay? Those don't exist.
Okay, I now request our